I'm Sue Ignato, class of 84, and I get the honor of introducing our guest speakers. So first, thanks to everyone coming, and I just want to show a hands. How many people here have a startup they want to sell? Okay, how many people here have a startup they want to buy? Connect after, okay? Just look.
Work is done.
I'm done, okay. So first, I want to introduce Drew Banks. This, I think, to me represents kind of the spirit of MIT, because Drew and I are colleagues, clients, and friends. So it's a great circle and a representation of how wonderful it is to have gone to the school and work with people who go to the school. So Drew is a North Carolina State University graduate and engineer turned MIT business guy who spent two decades in Silicon Valley, split between the former computer visualization giant Silicon Graphics, where I met Drew, and the home networking company he co-founded, Pi Digital. During his first 3 years at Prezi, and if you haven't used Prezi, use it, okay. It's a presentation software. He built and ran the marketing, sales, and support organizations. Now as head of international, Drew fans the flame of Prezi's growing global adoption. Drew also writes. He's published a couple of business books on communication and social media, as well as a couple of novels on, we'll just say, life. Okay, so that's Drew. And then I want to introduce Steve. And Steve is a brand new dad, 3 days. I think he's awake. And it's a Sloaney baby. He met his wife at Sloan. So all on all fronts. So I looked at Steve's long list here, and this guy's been busy. He is a successful entrepreneur and investor with 20 years experience founding and managing technology companies. Here's Steve by the numbers. He's raised more than $250,000 in capital. Billion. Thank you. But everyone's listening now. $250 million in capital. All right, make sure I get all the numbers right, okay? he's founded 7 companies and has been through a half dozen acquisitions. He's currently co-founder and CEO of All Classes, the world's largest search engine for online and offline classes. Prior to All Classes, Steve was founder and CEO of Matchbox, an enterprise software company in higher education that was acquired in 2014. That's recent. From 2008 to 2011, Steve was a venture partner at New Atlantic Ventures, an early stage venture fund based right here in Boston. Before joining New Atlantic Ventures, Steve was founder and CEO of Marcus Spectrum Holdings, and this is parenthetical, which I found very interesting, acquired by National Grid and twice by Nextel. So there is a story about how you can sell things twice. Right? A wireless spectrum investment fund, VoiceLink, a mission-critical wireless voice and data carrier, the Marcus Group, also acquired by Global Tower Partners, a wireless tower development and site acquisition company, Marcus Holdings, a venture investment and advisory firm, and FutureNet, an IT consulting company. He's been an angel investor and advisor in nearly a dozen startup companies, a mentor and investor in the Designer Fund. He holds an MBA from MIT Sloan and a bachelor's degree from Worcester Polytech Institute. So let's have a warm welcome for our... Hi, Neil.
I think I need to redo my bio. So I'm going to talk a bit about visual communications, and then I'm going to hand it over to Steve to talk about what this speech is billed as, which is selling your company. Right now, we are in a heyday of visual communications. And for me, as a visual communications junkie, that really, really excites me. In a moment, I'm going to give a more academic argument of why this heyday of visual communications is actually positively impacting the evolution of human communication. That argument is going to hinge on how the human brain is wired for visual spatial communication. But I'm going to preface that argument by saying it's irrelevant for those of us in this room. It's irrelevant because those of us in business are competing for eyeballs. So regardless of how the human brain works, we're competing for eyeballs, whether we have an online product or whether we advertise online or advertise offline, we're competing for eyeballs. And most of these eyeballs are embedded in people who grew up reading comic books, surfing the net, playing video games. They are highly attuned to visual communications. And I'll venture to say that these people, if you put more than two lines of text in front of them, are going to have a hard time staying focused on it. And God help me to get through an hour and a half presentation without visual communications, because these eyeballs are going to be looking down to their digital devices very, very quickly. In fact, I'm sure some of them are already. So it's no surprise that there are a lot of new tools that are coming out to help visual communications. There's infographics, there's motion graphics, there's Prezi. So it is really not a surprise, because the people that are attuned to consuming information right now are consuming it visually. There have been complete industries disrupted by visual communications. I'll just give one example. The home rental market, it was dominated by VRBO, which launched in 1995. And then HomeAway came in 2005 and started doing something. And then Airbnb came in 2008 that was founded by two graphic designers and an engineer. Now, that was unheard of when I got to Silicon Valley. I'll talk about that in a minute. You didn't have design-founded companies. These guys started in a competitive space and said, let's put pretty pictures on the places that we're renting and see how that does. I mean, there's more to it than that. But that was a big part of their strategy. That would move the needle for them. And now, if you don't know, Airbnb is the dominant player in this market. So it's a complete disruption. So when I moved from Boston to Silicon Valley, there was no one talking about design. There was Apple. And Apple, and you, ooh, ah, Apple. Well, back then, Apple was on the brink of financial destruction. Everyone was waiting. It was early 90s. People were waiting for them to shut their doors. So no one was looking to Apple to disrupt a market back then. There was the company I was at, SGI, that was introducing the world to visualization, to 3D visualization. And you would think that SGI was a design-driven company. We're soon. Absolutely not. You got back behind the doors of Silicon Graphics, and it was completely engineering-driven. In fact, poor people in marketing, like Sue, had to really struggle. They were second-class citizens. So it was funny. I was talking to a couple of Sloan students, or a group of Sloan students, yesterday, and there's this one guy from Alabama, and I said, oh, you're the quota, because I was the Southern quota in my class. I was the one from the South. And he said, I'm a UI designer, and I really feel like there's not much opportunity for me, so I'm going to go into consulting for the summer. I'm like, what do you, and everyone at the table was like, what do you mean? As a UI designer right now, it's on fire. You can go anywhere. You can walk in any company if you're good and be a product manager. So I think he felt pretty good after that conversation. So now is the point where if you buy that argument, you can like look at your cell phones, look at your digital devices, because I'm going to do the more academic argument here. You know, ever since the beginning of mankind, we've had to use spatial visual communication to survive. We had to come out of our cave, we had to find the berries that weren't poisonous, and if a predator came, we had to make it back to the cave really fast. The way you do that is by seeing things and figuring out how to navigate. And this is not just an inherent quality of the human species. It can be trained. And it's long been known that you can train your memory. You can train your visual memory. Back in the days of Greek orators, back in the days, would actually use something called the method of loci to remember things better. So they would create these long speeches, like an hour and a half speech, like today. And they would sit in their abodes, and they would divide the speeches up into sections, and they would put pieces of the speeches in the corners of the room. And so they would go, okay, the beginning of the speech is here, the second part is here, third part's here, fourth part's here. And then when they walked out of that room, and it was just a distant memory, they would still be able to remember, oh, the introduction of the speech. They would visualize that area and remember that piece of the speech. And I'm going to demonstrate actually how this works, and I'm going to turn to Sue. And this was not planned.
Don't make me remember anything, Drew.
So it's pretty easy. Name three appliances in your kitchen.
Coffee maker, microwave.
No, I would be willing to bet, although you did it fast, but if you're like most people, you did not go through a bullet list in your mind. You visualized your kitchen, and you pictured the coffee maker, and you pictured where everything was.
Mostly because I need coffee.
Okay, sorry. I'll pick up the pace here. So that's how, that's how we remember things. We remember things visually and spatially. It's really our semantic memory, not so great. If I throw a long list of bullet points on here, a lot of text, you're not going to remember that. But if I can navigate you through a space, it's more likely I'll keep your attention and more likely that you'll remember. There's a guy, Jonathan Ford, that wrote a book on this called Moonwalking with Einstein. It's a really great book if you want to read more about this. And he researched winners of the World Memory Championship. There's this bizarre championship where you learn how to you showcase your memory by going through a deck of cards or mini deck of cards, and you showcase how well you can remember each card in order. And there's an 8-time winner. There are a lot of winners that actually say that they learned how to remember things better by using this method. And there's an 8-time winner that talks about it, that he talks about in this book. But now I'm going to go to presentation design. I'm going to talk about how visual communication sort of lends itself to presentation design. I do work for Prezi. I'll try not to make a Prezi commercial. And so in order not to make a Prezi commercial, I'll actually correlate presentation design to cinema. Because I think cinematographic techniques have been going through a heyday for a lot longer than presentation design. It's been the last 50 to 60 years. And one of my favorite techniques that relates specifically to Prezi is something called the long take. Who knows what the long take is? Okay, I saw a nodding head, but I'm gonna sort of start it off and see if you can name the direct. Oh, someone raised their hand. Yeah,
Tessa d'Urberville, the first 7 minutes of the movie was one single.
Exactly. It was one camera shot. The director that came up with the long take, it was in 1949, and he believed that something was lost when you had tightly edited sequential frames, which is very much like, a presentation, edited sequential slides. He believed especially the audience engagement, you could lose audience engagement, an emotional engagement. And so he came up with this idea for a movie that he was creating. This was 1949. Can anyone guess the director and the movie?
Hitchcock
was the director.
And it was Rogue.
Rogue, wow. Yeah, wow.
Long memory.
That's good. Yeah, so Rope is based on a true story of two friends killing a friend of theirs because they wanted to feel what it was like to kill. And then in the movie, I don't know if this part's true, they put him in a sideboard and invited more friends over, put the dead body in a sideboard, and wanted to feel what it was like to be on the brink of that, someone discovering them. And what Hitchcock wanted to do was keep that emotional tension by always having the sideboard in the camera. So when someone would walk out of that room, he would keep the camera going toward the person but have a corner of the sideboard. I don't think it's a great movie, so I'm not showing you a clip from that. I'm showing you a different clip that does, I think, a great job of the long take. It's from Goodfellas, and it's the opening scene. It's a little bit of a long clip, but there's a reason why I'm going to take you through the whole thing. Let's see if the sound works. Yeah.
There you go.
every time I come here. Every time you do. Would you want
Okay, so the reason I think that is so brilliant is that didn't only create a mood, you actually learn everything about this guy in like this opening scene, even though he says very little. And that line of what do you do, I mean, the audience knows what he does. She doesn't know what he does, but the audience knows what he does. And I think that kind of continuity of a camera, which is one of the things Prezi does really well, actually the ancillary information that's coming in the peripheral vision and the continuity of the camera actually conveys a lot. I think it's very important to visual storytelling. Next thing I want to talk about is non-linear storytelling. And this is a term that gets used with Prezi a lot, but I want to talk about it in first the way that it's used in literature and then cinema and then talk about presentations. The first the first person to popularize non-linear literature was Marcel Proust. Does anyone know what the concept was he popularized and what cookie he used to popularize it with? I'm looking up here because that's where the answers get. You do?
So remembrance is something passive.
That's right. That's the book. The Madeline's a cookie.
Yeah, well, I'm sure.
What is the concept called? Close, very close. It's involuntary memory. So it was like he's in the book. He dips his Madeline into a cup of tea, and then has this 300-page sycophantic memory of his mother. If there was anyone that needed therapy, it was Proust. Beautifully written, but wow. And so he really popularized it in literature. And there's a movie that popularized sort of nonlinear storytelling. Anyone? It's actually reported to be one of the best movies of all time. No, what?
Groundhog Day.
No, no, or a lot, no, background. Citizen Kane, who said Citizen Kane? Yeah, Citizen Kane really worked on this in this concept of memory. It's interesting because, you know, these presentations are inherently linear. Those stories are linear. They have frame after frame after frame. What I've shown you right here is linear. Prezi's a linear presentation delivery tool, even though people call it nonlinear a lot. The two things about Prezi that are great with nonlinearity are the presentation design process, because it's an open canvas. It's like using a whiteboard. And that's where nonlinearity comes in. There's also a point in presentations, if there's a Q&A period, where nonlinearity can come in, where I've given a long presentation of several slides or frames, and you ask a question, and I can go back immediately to that frame without having to go back. And that's people that use Prezi really well can do that very effectively. Teachers that they can actually just go back to exactly where you're talking. So that's Citizen Kane. Now I'm going to do four other correlations of cinematic techniques with presentation. First is movement equals meaning. I'm gonna go back to Hitchcock here, and I'm gonna talk about vertigo. So vertigo, Hitchcock really experimented with camera movement here. And I'm not talking about camera movement to just engage an audience. I mean, that's, you know, PowerPoint transitions or camera movements that engage an audience and keep you awake, but they don't have meaning. There's two examples in Vertigo that I want to show you where camera movement equals meaning. The first is a famous 360-degree camera around a kissing couple, Jimmy Stewart and the leading lady, I think Kim Novak. And what Hitchcock was trying to do, when vertigo is dizziness, where its circularity creates anxiety or height creates anxiety. And so what he's trying to do in this scene is actually create anxiety here. And you feel the Jimmy Stewart getting anxious, even though it's a very romantic moment. And midway through the scene, you'll see him pull back and start questioning whether his leading lady has all that leading right here. So he does the whole circle around them, and there's the music then echoes this. The second one is point of view. So you'll notice here, you all of a sudden go to the point of view of him climbing stairs, which, so you see what he sees, and that's supposed to create anxiety. You can do this in presentations as well. I'm going to stick on point of view, and like if I'm giving a presentation on somebody's point of view, and I'm like, here's the point of view, but here's the opposite point of view. And so that movement, that rotation upside down, actually reinforces what I just said as an opposite point of view. I can also go and like, I can slowly turn the point of view back around. And that turning sort of reinforces what I'm saying. That movement, when it reinforces meaning, is great. I think movement, when it just is meant to entertain, it's okay, but it's not as powerful. Second one, very similar, but this is the hardest thing to do, I think, in both cinema and in presentations, when the overall structure has meaning as well. So when the structure of a movie actually has inherent meaning, or the structure of a presentation. So a great example of this is a movie, one of my favorite movies, called Memento. And so the Memento, anyone seen Memento? So it's a backward structure. So you start at the end of the movie and then move to the beginning. And it's about a guy that's lost his memory. So it actually reinforces, as he's trying to remember, the structure of the movie reinforces. There's a famous a presentation expert called Andrew Abela. I think he lives in Italy, in Rome. And he talks about slides. We don't use the term slide at Prezi, but he talks about slides, the inherent structure of a slide having meaning. And he's got a blog post on this, and it's called The Squint Test. 36 slides that pass the squint test. And so what the squint test is if you squint at what's on the screen, you still know what it's about. You get what it's about. And these are three of his slides there. And you get, if you squint at those, that the bottom one's an org chart. You get that the one in the top right is a decision tree and the other one is opposing forces. It's great if you can get an overarching structure to reinforce meaning. It's also very difficult, I think. A similar technique that's not as difficult is metaphor. So visual metaphor implying meaning, and a lot of movies use this. I'm going to use one of my favorites, and I think you have a picture of the lead actor from this movie in your presentation. So, The Matrix. Can anyone tell me what the overarching, well, one of the metaphors is The Matrix. Now, my husband is a gynecologist and an obstetrician, and he believes that, like, all metaphors in sci-fi are about birth. And I was like, well, it's true. Sort of when you look at sci-fi, there's birth metaphor in almost every. But that's not the, and there is a birth metaphor in The Matrix, but the one, this will give you a hint. Does anyone remember what's shown there? Red pill, blue pill. So, you know, he offers where the red pill you engage in real life and the blue pill you continue to live your false life. I don't know if there was a politicalness behind that, but I would still take the blue pill. So in presentations is a place where you can use this much, much more heavily than you can in movies or in books. Because in books and movies, you want to nuance that, right? You want a metaphor to, you know, you don't want the realization to hit you over the head. You want to get to the end and think, wow, was that a metaphor or not? In a presentation, you want it to hit, you want to set an audience's expectation immediately and set the framework, and then you can tell the story. I'm going to give an example of where this was recently done incredibly well. Recently, there was in Mexico, a prominent national journalist, Carmen Aristegui, broke a major, major scandal, national scandal, about prostitution in the government. And she broke it using a Prezi that was one of our standard templates, which is a desktop template. And she basically, she starts off by saying this was a scandal. And then she says there was ads posted for secretaries, and she shows the ad that's posted. And then she gets a conversation. This was a reporter.
Bueno.
And this is a reporter telling a candidate to go to a certain address, and then she talks about arriving at that address, the map of where the address was, and then as the candidate was being prepared to go into the interview, she was told that she needed to be prepared to have sex, and that the interviewer didn't really like protected sex. And so it was like a really big scandal. It actually was picked up by The Economist the next day. I mean, it's still going on. It's a great example, though, of the Prezi, the desktop, like really set it visually. I mean, it's set, the user was ready to go there and then just walk through the path points, as opposed to trying to tell that in a just textual narrative, it would have been very difficult to do. The last one, the final one, quite appropriately, is called The Final Reveal. This is very similar to metaphor or structure, except you do it at the end as opposed to at the beginning. So this is when you're in the details in a movie. Usually mystery movies do this. And at the very end, you pull back and you're like, wow, that was what was going on. I didn't get it. That was what was going on. A movie that does this incredibly well is Usual Suspects. It's great. It's really great. It's a mystery movie, a whodunit movie. And the final scene, the lead investigator is looking at a big bulletin board. Let's see. And he sees a clue. And he's missed this clue. And it's at the bottom left-hand side of the bulletin board. And then it moves that back, and all of a sudden, you see all the clues. They're all there on the bulletin board. And he just goes through each one by one. And it's amazing, because you if someone didn't tell you about the movie, you didn't know that either. And you get to experience that with him. I'll give an example of a presentation that did this really well. Prezi last year, I told you it wouldn't be a commercial, but I'm referencing us a lot, apologize. But last year we had a contest in conjunction with TED conferences. People know TED here? So it was about how could we make a TED talk, a past TED talk, even better than it was using Prezi. And we had 5 different TED talks, so a lot of people entered. And the TED talk that won was by Brian Stevenson, and it's about injustice, about black male incarceration. And here's the Chris Anderson, the curator of TED, and Peter Arvizio of Prezi giving out the award to this woman, Hedwig, whose last name I can't pronounce. It's a very long Dutch name. And what Hedwig did was actually fairly straightforward statistics of black incarceration, and then some powerful words. The opposite of poverty is not wealth, but justice. And these words came directly from Brian Stevenson. And then the very last frame, she pulls out, and you see that the whole presentation has been in this word, identity, which is a word that Brian Stevenson uses a lot, and then it, you know, gives him. And that, so you, again, you as the watcher of this presentation, you pull out at the same time, go, wow, that's all of that description was in the word. So those are the ways, those are 4 or 5 different techniques that I think parallel in cinema, which again I think is about 50 years ahead of presentations. Presentation technology, quite honestly, slides is a 350-year-old concept. when computers came. It is. It was based on the magic camera that was invented in Scandinavia way back in the Middle Ages to tell ghost stories. So you put a pinprick and you projected an image through it. When computers came out, basically all we did was put that on the computer without thinking about what are the visualization powers of a computer. I mean, can you imagine if we were doing storytelling on cinema like we were 50 years ago? I can tell you the young people in this room wouldn't watch it. I mean, they wouldn't. Who's seen a movie before 1970? Okay. Who's seen a movie before 1970 and is younger than 40? Yeah. And I know you. This is my husband. He can't sit through them. I try. I'm like, Luke, but the dialogue. Listen to the dialogue. He's like, well, but it's not going anywhere. There's nothing to watch. And I try. I try. Manchurian Candidate. It's the closest. I got him to watch that one all the way through. That was great. So I want to tell a little bit about me before I hand it over to Steve and how I got to be so obsessed on visual communications. So I, in my blog, talk about being an accidental entrepreneur, which is true. I never wanted to be an entrepreneur. I had someone ask me if I could help them write a business plan, and I said yes. Anyone that's ever done that knows that's a slippery slope into being an entrepreneur. But I'm actually an accidental businessman, and people in my class, some of them know this. I never intended to come into business school. I was in New York dancing and doing artistic things. And I was also doing engineering things. And I was sitting in the lunchroom one day, and I told one of my colleagues, I'm like, I got to get out of New York. She's like, have you ever thought of business school? And I thought, don't you need to want to do business? And she goes, no, it's just a way to change your life. seriously. And so I signed up for the GMAT. And then Sloan was the first school I ever visited because I'd gotten accepted here, or maybe it was before I got accepted. And it just felt right. I mean, it felt amazingly right, and I couldn't put it into words then. But something just felt like I was like, wow, I've been waiting for this for a long time. And I didn't know what it was. So I was so not thinking of business school that during my middle year, I didn't want to do an internship. I'm like, oh, you don't need to do an internship, which is so stupid. I met some, did they still have the MBA games? Anyone remember where you swim across a pool with a Wall Street Journal in your hand? Crazy thing. I met some second years at Kellogg at the NBA games that were doing relief work in the Caribbean. And I was like, wow, that's cool. I'm going to go with you. And they're like, you need to do an internship, buddy. I'm like, no, I'm going to go do relief work. And I was on the island of Dominica, and someone at MIT had given my resume to a woman that both Sue and I worked with. And I'm like, and she got a hold of me on Dominica. There were like 3 phones on Dominica. And I was like, you found my resume, got a hold of me, and you want to come the second half of the summer to San Francisco? Absolutely, I'll be there. And then I went to this place, SGI. And again, I thought it was San Francisco or that I was just so lucky to get interested without trying. But there was something about SGI. I was like, wow, this is great. And midway through SGI, I took a class by this guy, Edward Tufte. It was a seminar. And this was sort of mind-blowing. At the time, everyone was saying, for slides, you want 3 bullet points, and that's you simplify everything. You really, to keep your audience, you simplify. And I was like, something didn't sound right about that to me. And this guy said, that's bullshit. He's like, you put complex information. It's about simplifying complexity. It's not about simplification or oversimplification. He said, put complex information up there and simplify it. And he gives this great example of Napoleon's march to Russia, which just has so much information on it. But you can understand it. It was like a great infographic. He also did something in this book, in this class, that really, really blew my mind. He was talking about early geometry, and he had this old textbook from Euclid in his hand. He's like, you know what? When you're coming up with ideas in early geometry, no one's heard of these. It's really hard to communicate these in text. I mean, how do you communicate? You know, of course, through mathematical equations, but you want to communicate more broadly than that. And he pulls open this text, one of the original texts, which he still has, and he replicates it in this book, and he shows that they did a pop-up to describe a pyramid. They did maybe the first ever pop-up known. like a pop-up of a pyramid. He still like delicately pulls it up off this like paper thin. And I was like, man, that is so powerful. To be able to, it was like I walked out of that class and I was running communications at SGI at the time. And I was like, well, I'm going to communicate, in a very different way. After SGI, this was when the person asked me to write I left because I was crashing. I wrote a couple of books, and a couple of business books, a couple of novels, and then a friend asked me to write a business plan, and I started this company, Pi Digital, which is a home networking company. It's an ecosystem of technology, both consumer and enterprise, to simplify the home networking situation, simplify installing a router and all. We saw a proliferation of devices coming into the home and wanted to solve that. It's my own company. It was boring as hell. I was like, wow, this is so boring. And there were some other challenges, so I left. And I was going to take a year off. I was exhausted. And I ran into Peter Arvai, who's the CEO of Prezi. It was my last networking event. And he's like, let me show you my company. And I'm like, I'm not interested. I don't want to hear about technology. I'm seriously not interested. And as a good entrepreneur would, he kept talking. He said, I don't care if you're not interested. I'm going to tell you about my company. And I was like, And he told me this very complicated thing about mathematical visualization. I'm like, you mean your PowerPoint meets Google Maps? That's what you are. And he was like, wow, how'd you come up with that so quickly? I'm like, well, that's what you just said in like really long words. And so 2 weeks later, I was flying to Hungary. And Hungary there was something about Hungary as well. And I've come, and now I'm living in Budapest right now, and I've come to realize that all three of these, MIT, SGI, five of them, Tufte, Prezi, and Hungary, all have something in common. And though that is design, technology, mathematics, and linguistics. And there's something about, for me, when that all comes together, that really sort of rocks my world. If you really peel back Prezi, it's completely sort of mathematically algorithm underneath with great design. And there's something in Hungary about the technology education, mathematics education, design education. I would throw music in here, although I've never played music, but there's something about music there too. I love it. And I pull out a bit further. When I was in New York, I was a little bit on the right brain side of that. And when I was doing my own company, it was a bit on the left brain. I need both. So that's my background, and that's why I love visual communications. But now to talk about the selling the company part, which he's sold several, and he's invested in several, I'm going to hand it over to Steve Marcus.
Can I ask you a question first?
Sure.
So I was in the earlier presentation today with Dr. Pratt, and he was talking about optimizing productivity, that when you're doing a meeting, always give the presentation out first so people have a chance to read it. I don't see how you could give out a presentation like this. So I would like to have your thoughts on meeting management and presentations, providing it ahead of time, afterwards, telling the story, when you tell the story.
Yeah, sure. There are many reasons to give presentations, I think. One is to sort of share ideas, brainstorm ideas. One is to document decisions. And I think for documenting decisions where you have, I could go on and on about this. Documenting decisions, like Prezi would not be a great solution. This kind of presentation is not because you want to actually read about the decision. I would also say for text-heavy presentations. What our research has shown is that when you have text-heavy presentation, because the human brain's not great at semantic information dissemination, what happens is you bifurcate the attention span of the audience. So I have a lot of text on here. You're going to be reading the text and trying to pay attention to me. And that's not going to work because your brain doesn't work that way. But if I have visuals on here, your brain does work at putting visuals in context. I actually can become the presentation where that becomes the backdrop, as opposed to two different, you're trying to read this and I'm trying to present you those words. So if I had text heavy, I'd do the same thing. I'd present it in the beginning or hand it out, and I would make sure that it was fully documented. And I probably wouldn't use Prezi for that. But if I'm wanting to engage an audience and really sort of share an idea with them, especially if I want to brainstorm that idea like I usually do in meetings, I want something where I'm the center of attention, and that what I'm presenting is the backdrop, so I can engage that audience and actually have their mind fully focused on what I'm saying. And then when they ask a question, they can be fully engaged as well. Did that?
Yeah. Along those lines, if you go to an executive presentation and I decide to use final review or metaphor, I'm kicked out of that room 5 minutes. How do you marry those things, right?
Yeah.
It's usually it's like, okay, give me the conclusion first, then get out and give me the details.
You know, it was very similar when the internet just came out and people thought it was a fad. I mean, I was presenting, I remember presenting, people were like, you can't use talk about e-commerce with executives, because e-commerce is a fad. And at some point, it became not a fad, and core. It became core to what the executive team, core to what a board was thinking about as a distribution channel for sales. I would think. I believe that in the same way that the people's narrow concept of presentations is going to expand. Now, if that executive just wants a decision, he's like, show me the decision, document the decision. It's not a presentation. Or it is, or it's a PowerPoint deck. Give them the deck. You can send them the deck ahead of time, read through the deck. That decision's at the end, that we're done. But if they want a discussion, that's a very different kind of, that's a very, very different kind of interaction. I mean, it's, you know, like being a professor. This kind of presentation would work very well and it does. It's one of the reasons presidents really deeply adopt in education. It works very well in the classroom. Whereas PowerPoint presentation, I mean, really text-heavy PowerPoint, not so much, unless they're homework and you go home and read them. So, and I'm not saying that people won't, like, there are people that are, we present to our board on Prezi, of course, it's our board. But our, you know, CFO was the hardest to pull over, but he's like, you know, it's great because I can put in this big spreadsheet and I can zoom in to, like, what the problem area is and zoom out. So basically, he just cuts, he just does screenshots of Excel and then zooms in and out. But he feels really sort of creative about it. Uh-oh, I'm being taped. Sorry, Joel. Great. Steve?
Thanks, Drew. Hey, everybody. So I have a few different presentations because I didn't know exactly, wanted to take a poll of the audience here and find out what you guys really want to learn. And I'll talk about, I have a very distinct visual style. I've adjusted some things over time, but a lot of people like the pitch decks that I put together. I have a whole variety of decks, you know, for a business. I'll develop some different ones depending on the scenarios, you know, whether I'm pitching to venture capital audience or employees or, you know, potential suppliers, customers, doesn't matter. So actually just want to take a poll here. So how many of you are interested in raising capital for a company? Want to learn about that? How many of you want to learn about the selling process, about how to sell a company to somebody? It's about an even split. How many just want to be better presenters? Doesn't really matter what the topic is. All right. So we'll use this lens then. We'll talk about venture capital, and I'll give you my cliff notes on how I put this deck together. I put this particular deck together for a Sloan audience as well. So this is about raising a first round of capital. I'm just going to go through, you know, the types of capital available, you know, what a process looks like to get the capital, some traps and pitfalls in those processes, and, you know, how to pick up the signals because VC is a mess, but and where to get more info. And as Sue said, I am a professional bio writer. I write very non-humble bios about people, but I've done a lot of things. I just have, I think, restless leg syndrome, so I've been an entrepreneur for a long time. It's the only thing I know. I've tried to change my destiny a few times. I did an internship at Amazon when I was at Sloan, but I'm a Sloan 08. I've raised more than $250 million of capital from private equity and VC, all by accident, just got into some really good ideas and needed money for them, so that's invariably what happened. I think I should stand in front here, right? Am I okay here? Doesn't matter. All right. I've been a VC, so I did VC part-time and full-time for about 3 years. I've been an investor in several venture funds. I've been an angel investor in a dozen startups. Fair to say that I know the venture capital game quite well. I just raised $1.5 million for all classes, which I think you heard a little bit in the beginning. It's a search engine for classes. It's very fresh for me, this topic, so I'm happy to walk through it. Raising money is frustrating. A lot of times, you know, VCs have the attention span of a gnat. How many of you, actually, is there any VCs in the room here? All right, so one of you, you may or may not like this talk. VCs have the attention span of a gnat. Usually I have to hit them really quickly with part of what Drew was saying. You have to hit them with the punchline really early and talk about the elephants in the room early. But I co-founded All Classes with another Sloaney, an 09, who's actually having their reunion this year, Chad Lovell. Raising money is frustrating. And it really is, there's a slew of bad actors, and I think Drew mentioned this. You may or may not think he's a bad actor. Slew of bad actors in VC. If you find a good one, they are really worth everything. Unfortunately, there's a lot of bad ones. It takes a long time to figure out if a VC is a good one or a bad one. It takes 6 years, they say, to figure out if a money manager can return money on a fund is cut above the rest. So it takes a long time to figure it out. Venture capital is really rocket fuel. As you know, in a lot of my decks, you'll start seeing this. I use a lot of imagery. I'm trying to keep you on your toes all the time. I don't want you to know my style of a deck. I want you to look at this. I want you to decipher it. I want you to think about the slide for a second. I like using a lot of images. Sometimes they are related to the topic. Sometimes they're just an image that looks good, and you're like, wow, that looks really cool. And you'll listen to me for a second and then continue on the next slide. If it's a presentation for an audience that I am talking to the first time, I slow down the topics. I make them very like one slide, one idea. I turn a slide every 30 seconds. No less than that, because if it's too fast, you won't find out what I'm talking about. If it's too quick, I mean, if it's too slow, you'll just, all right, I got it, and then you'll stop paying attention. VC is rocket fuel. It's only one type of fuel. If you find yourself with a rocket-powered sled, you will have a problem. So that's why it is a very distinct type of capital. It doesn't mean that's the only way to raise money. Okay, so the first thing you should do is do some homework. In any presentation, you want to be the expert. I'm walking in here and telling you that I raise money for All Classes. You expect that I have done the research on All Classes. I'm not just, you know, some guy came up with an idea, 20 of something else. You really want to make sure that I know the topic. And I want to know the customers. I want to know everything. I want to know my space. I want to know strengths and weaknesses. I want to know, you know, what really are the elephants in the room. There are a lot of venture funds. Many, many fish in this pond. There are thousands of them. There are lots of places to get capital. It just means that if somebody says no, there are more to go. Don't give up. It only takes one person to say, yes, I've been an investor. Let me get your first one out of the way. No. That way you guys feel a lot better. You get a lot of no's. You just get a lot of no's. Enternock is a famous story in Boston that got 26 no's before somebody, one of my partners in my venture fund, said yes, went public, great success story. I got 100 no's in All Classes when I started, 100 no's. And I've refined my deck, oh my God, so many times. God forbid you raise money or you're successful in your company, you have to tell your story to everybody over and over again. I got to tell my mom, I got to tell my uncle, I got to tell my kids, I got to tell everybody. So it really is a story you have to master. I know my story so well with All Classes, I don't even need the deck. I can just talk about it in a 30-second version, a 3-hour version, 45-day version. I have every version. Co Everywhere got 200 no's. 200 no's before somebody wrote them a $6 million check. Never give up. One of the things that I like to do is I try to recruit people that are knowledgeable about the space. If you know what you're doing, put your credentials at the beginning. All Classes, technically, I don't know what I'm doing. So I don't have credentials in it. I've never started a search engine. I barely know the consumer internet space. Putting my credentials up front, everybody's going to be like, hey, what the hell are you doing with this company? So I don't put it at the front, typically. If you have a lot of credibility and you're like, hey, listen, I founded Kayak, and now I'm doing classes, search engine for classes, no matter what you say, you're probably going to get somebody to pay attention. So I usually like to say, well, somebody from Kayak told me this, or I did the research. I call all the people that are the experts in an area, and I try to get them to give me some insight on the business that I'm about to get into. So I can say, well, you know, the founder of Kayak or the founder of Indeed said this, that, and the other thing. And they're like, are you calling them a liar? So it's usually better to have that ammo with you. It's a tough process. You know, raising money is sort of like a blitz thing. You really need to get everybody in line at the same time. and a pitch for venture capital is, you know, it's something that you need to start with in the beginning, a couple funds just to get your feet wet. But after a while, if you don't have everybody on the same page, you might lose momentum. A lot of times, you know, raising money is a momentum thing. Practice your pitch on your mom, in front of the, you know, the mirror. It doesn't matter what it is. Got to be able to just get up there and give that pitch. So a lot of times, I practice it just on anybody that I can find. Get a term sheet from anybody. The VC game is about just getting a term sheet in the beginning, just to say your baby's not ugly, that they just want somebody to say yes. It usually means, implies somebody did some research or somebody has already said, hey, you know, this is worthwhile, let's spend some time on it. But it really doesn't matter who you get it from, you just need a term sheet. I find that a lot of this is like dating. You know, you really just need somebody to validate that you're interesting, seeing you talk to them in the bar, and then everything is hunky-dory. I usually don't put formulas in my decks, but if I do, I give you very simple math. You guys could figure this out, just about where the valuations go. A lot of people are worried about how much equity they give up in a deal. Usually the smart money takes a little bit more of your company. Not so smart money takes a little bit less. So it really is all over the map. There's a lot of firm math in here. I'm not going to skip this part because it's... I did one of my major faux pas. I never put this much text on a slide. This is what my wife does, who's a tech M&A banker, to give somebody a lot of documents. You can treat a deck like a document. But this is about, somebody asked me this question and I sent this deck around afterwards, just about the firm math, about how much capital is kept and reserved. A first meeting is a first date. It's just to get to know you, just to know who you are. You know, it can be 20 or 30 minutes. The second meeting is something a little bit more, meet some friends, maybe double date, do that kind of thing. Third meeting is meet everybody at the fund. And if you don't get to a partner meeting, you're probably not going to get a deal. At the end of the day, you know, a partner meeting is where everything gets decided. You really, really need to get to a partner meeting, unless you find a firm that has one partner who's the decision maker. And it really matters the audience you go into. So venture funds, I'll shape my deck depending on who I'm talking to. Unfortunately, this is like an oral presentation. I have to talk to you, and I carry my crib notes with me on my Evernote. But this is a visual and an oral presentation. If you're a kinesthetic learner and you need to do something with your hands the whole time, I'm screwed. Like, this is a tough deck to go through. This is a tough presentation to go through. I'm a kinesthetic learner. This is about the worst thing for me possible. Usually kinesthetic learners will stop you mid-flight and say, hey, so let's talk about this thing, let's talk about that thing, let's walk me through that. West Coast fundraising, go raise money on the West Coast. It's just the way it is. It's a different world over there, a lot more money, money flows a lot more freely over there. It's just the cold hard truth that it's a better place to be. Got a funny story about this. I was on the East Coast, and I'm an East Coast VC, right? So for me, I had known East Coast for 3 years. Go to raise money for Matchbox, actually. And I get on the East Coast and meet with a couple firms. I'm like, hey, how much money are you raising? Okay, you know, $2.5 million. So like, whoa, hey, that's a lot of money for, you know, seed stage company. All right, well, you know, this is how much money you need for enterprise software to get going. So all right, we'll think about it. Go out to the West Coast, and my first meeting is with a top tier fund. And I sit down and say, oh, great presentation. So how much are you raising? I said, $2.5 million. They're like, well, we're not talking about a lot of money. I'm not sure anybody would get on the plane to go to the East Coast for that little. I'm like, what? Are you serious? So I go talk to my buddy who's raised a ton of money. And I said, so what am I doing wrong here? Like, I don't understand. Like, I say $2.5 million on the East Coast. Everybody looks at me like, that's a lot of money. He's like, well, you know, anybody worth their salt's going to walk in and say, I need at least $5 million to start. So I go back and I redo all my numbers, and my next meeting is another top tier fund. I get through it, slam dunk presentation. The guy's like, yeah, get it. So how much are you raising? $5 million. Yeah, I see that. That's reasonable. What are you thinking, like 5 on 15 million pre? It's like, yeah, that's what I'm thinking. What? I walked out of there and I had to pinch myself. I just sort of laughed, started laughing. I just couldn't believe it. Different perspective on the world, you know, just a lot of money chases deals, is what happens. I find it amusing. A lot of people start in the deal and they start asking you questions. You know, seed stage company, raising a first round of capital. You don't have anything, no proof points, no nothing yet, right? So I find it comical that people ask for a lot of information, you know, tell us what you've done. I haven't done anything. The company is brand new. If I had done things, I probably wouldn't be here asking for a seed round of capital. So there really isn't much data. So a lot of this is going to be talking about, people are going to want to hear about the product, they're going to want to hear about the vision, about, you know, talk about the customers, talk about the problem. And the best way I can say this is that I often coach people and say, well, imagine I gave you the cure for cancer. Some people, I mean, everybody knows cancer's a problem, and if you had the cure for cancer, that is awesome. That is a big market, a lot of people want it. Now you have to create a company to actually get the cancer treatment out into the market. And a lot of things can go wrong in it. A lot of times people don't even believe that you have the cure for something. So you have to sit there and talk about, well, what is that? What is that? So I think you have to really understand what your audience wants to hear. Like, some people will get it and some people won't. So how to kick off a process with this. So, you know, a lot of people want to go for the best. They want to try to practice, you know, pitching the best of the best, and they say, well, if, you know, the best say yes, then I don't need to work my way around anybody else. Reality is you should start with the worst people, because the worst people ask a lot of the same questions. They really do, and they really help you shape what you are going to combat. If you walk in there and say, I'm going to start a biotech company, you've never started a biotech company before, you probably should address that in your deck first off. But if you blow it with a top-tier firm, it's unlikely you're going to be able to go back there. So work your way up. It's the opposite of what you might think. Lots of firms out there. In fact, I was talking to Drew about this. It's if he ever started a company again, you know, VCs are a certain brand of business. And there are a lot of places to get capital these days. That's the good part. Lots and lots of firms. There are firms that are, you know, small little angel funds. There are people who do crowdsourcing now. I'm sure you guys have all heard about crowdsourcing. You can do a Kickstarter campaign. I mean, you literally can get a company funded from a lot of different places. There are a lot of top tier. There are several top tier firms. Not a huge amount of them, but they create most of the returns in the industry. It's just a fact. So a lot of these guys have great resumes. You should talk to a bunch of them. Again, I like to use images. I don't know what the lights have to anything to do with it, but looks cool. Yeah, exactly. So the ABCs of sales. So, you know, at the end of the day, it's a selling process. I don't like to send anybody my deck ahead of time. A lot of people will ask, hey, can you send me your deck? Who's better at telling your story than you guys? I mean, it's not a movie. It doesn't tell itself. It's not a document a lot of times. It's like this. I mean, what the hell can you understand from this if I didn't give you the commentary on it? So again, you want to go for firms. Those ABCs in this context are, there's a tier A, tier B, tier C firms. You want to work your way from the bottom to the top. That's an example. So don't send your deck. I told you that before. And I like a lot of these. I use a lot of slides where I have one sentence on it or one topic. And actually, one style I use sometimes is I'll change this color background. I'll just have a single color, like a bright yellow or a bright pink or a bright something that like wakes you up and has a text on it. That's all it is. We can all be visual experts. I use pictures, I use snippets of text, just one thought, just trying to go through really quickly, get you to pay attention. I usually don't do this. But at the end of the day, VCs, it's just like dating. They want to hear somebody thinks you're hot already. They want to hear about competitors. And you might want to be like, no one is doing this at all. Usually means it's a really bad business. You have to make a very big return to a fund. The bigger the fund, the bigger the business. If your business can't return $1 billion to a fund, a lot of times you're going to be unattractive to them. You got to be in a big market, right? If you start talking about little things, little markets, like I remember when I started my Matchbox business, which was, we were creating enterprise software for higher education, and specifically through admissions. Everybody's like, well, how big is admissions? And the first thing I would say is an $18 billion business. Everybody's like, whoa, holy, really? Are you serious? That was like my third slide, because I knew in the beginning everybody was going to give me a hard time about it. So they're going to want 20%. So if you guys are really nervous about giving up 20% of your company, don't raise venture capital. And it really is more dilutive for a founder. You actually have to give equity to other people. So you have to make an option pool that usually comes from you. And larger funds want more proof. Top tier, you know, you walk in, they're going to say, well, how come you don't already have 1 million users? Well, I just started it 3 weeks ago. I'm like, all right, we'll get out. You got to tell a good story. Some shit is really obvious to you and not obvious to other people. That's why you go to the lower tier first, is to figure out what is obvious and what is not. Sometimes you'll walk in the room and be like, well, we have a search engine for classes. And they're like, what's a class? Is that like yoga class? What kind of class are we talking about? We're talking about online classes? You really have to understand what people, you know, are naturally going to think about you. Don't talk about exits or returns. I remember somebody told me, started talking about unit economics in a startup. I'm like, unit economics? Like, you don't even know what your economics are going to be. You have an idea of what you think you can make or what you think you can do, but you have no idea how that company's going to operate yet. I mean, it's like telling me what your kid's future occupation is going to be if they were born 3 days ago, which I know what mine's going to be. No, I'm just kidding. They pattern match, so a lot of things are pattern matching. Find something that's like your business and start looking at some of the structural similarities to it. And careful what you promise. Careful what you promise. If you start saying, well, we're going to make $1 million next year, you're like, great, we'll invest. If you don't make $1 million next year, we're going to have a problem. So I very rarely put like a lot of really strong promises into a deck. I like to talk about them, and I like to work out reasonable objectives. Show screenshots. People love to see screens of things. And I know Drew's not going to like this, but there's one website I'm going to refer to you if you don't want to use Prezi, which Prezi's awesome. If you want to become an instant presentation star, just the layouts are really good at Keynote Pro. They have these like slide presentation layouts for specifically Keynote. I use a lot of them. It's helped me with my visual style. Go to KeynotePro.com and check it out. Even if you don't have Keynote, just you can look at the layouts. They look awesome. All right, when you're likely to get a no. You're likely to get a no a lot. So if somebody says, send me the deck, it usually means you are full of crap. That I do not like your business. I need your deck to sort of verify that that's the case. But if they already say that, it usually means it's too bad. If a partner introduces you to an analyst or an associate, your deal is probably dead. If a VC says, I am going to talk about you at a partner meeting, and they don't call you back after the partner meeting, your deal's probably dead. You only meet one partner. If you meet one person of the family, you are definitely not getting married. So that's it. If you don't meet the parents, you can have a problem. They don't return phone calls or emails or smoke signals. You write them a couple times, and it's radio silent. Your deal's dead. It's just like dating, right? I mean, it's like the same thing. You mean to get scheduled several weeks out. Well, I'd love to meet you, but I'm busy for the next 3 weeks. Your deal's dead. It sucks, but that's the truth. Bad body language. When I first walk into a room, my favorite one is I walked into a partner meeting, and one guy walks in the room, and there's a huge, long conference table. I'm sitting at the front. I'm the only person at the table. Only person. Guy walks all the way to the opposite end of the table. Like, well, that guy is definitely not interested. It's definitely not on my team. Let's put it that way. Or my favorite one is the walk in the room and everybody's got their hands crossed. I'm like, let's just stop here. This is not going to work. I'm just going to walk right out. I'm wasting my time. And your champion doesn't defend you. So if somebody comes in and they really like you, like, wow, Steve, you're great. I love all classes. Come on in. And they come in there and they're like, your deal sucks. This business is terrible. That's not good. My favorite pseudo yeses, the not yes and the not no, but kind of. I'm leaning very far forward. Sorry you have a posture problem, but I don't know why you're not investing in my company. If I were an angel, if I were somebody else, I would give you the money right now. Great, that's super. I'll just take that back to my team. Maybe they can eat that. Sales processes speed up to a close and they don't slow down. So if the frequency of the communication speeds up and people, you know, they start calling you and they start asking questions. I remember I went to Kleiner Perkins and I met John Doerr. John Doerr's like third question to me was, I want to talk to your third grade teacher. I want to talk to everybody. I want to hear about you. I want to know what this is. I mean, he just like was like hot and heavy right from the beginning. The worst thing about VC is you don't know if it, sometimes you might get in the beginning, you're like, wow, that sounds really interesting. And they don't know whether or not it's a dog or something they want to invest in. So they just lay it on thick. It's just like, yeah, we're sleeping together immediately. Let's do this. Come on. We'll worry about it. And then it just dies. So it's very hard sometimes in the beginning. You think everybody likes you, but then nobody likes you. So it's a tough process. You got to get your confidence through this thing. Yeah, it's going to lay in on thick. Recognize a yes. If people are like, yeah, yeah, oh, well, I get this. And they're finishing. They're telling you what your next slide is. They're like, hey, this is what you're going to talk about next, right? Then you're leaning towards a yes. The fastest yes I ever got was a 20-minute phone call. After 20 minutes, somebody gave me $450,000, right? 20 minutes later, I mean, it's a phone call. That was the worst pitch ever. Try to give up one of these over a phone. It's not easy. That was amazing. That doesn't happen, but it certainly can. I'm in. If people say, yeah, I'm in, we're in. Like, how much can we invest? That's when I got the $250 million call where somebody said, I want to put $250 million in to do this. That was a phone call. Said, we're in. We're doing this. That's good enough for me. If you have, like I said, if you haven't met the partnership, if you haven't met the family, it's very hard to get. Usually firms want to get behind somebody. So if you haven't met everybody, it's not going to work. And until the money's in the bank, you constantly need to sell them. Always need to sell them. I'll send them little tidbits. I'll send them a couple slides. I'll send them some stuff like, hey, this is news on us. This is something happening. Keep it going. How to suffer a bad beat. If you don't do any homework, or if they don't do any homework, the process is dead. I've had this happen to me so many times where somebody comes in, yeah, I really like it. They don't do any research. They get in front of the whole firm, and the firm's like, hey, you have these answers to these 10 questions? You're not even there. You have these 10 questions? They're like, I don't know. Deal's dead. It's tough. You start making absurd statements. Start making like absurd statements like, well, I think Walmart's going to compete with you. Who? What? Walmart? In what? Selling classes? What are you talking about? But random things. It's like, I don't understand what's going on here. They drag the process out. The worst thing is the slow no. I hate the slow no. Just tell me no to my face immediately. Look, I hate your business and I don't like you. This is not happening. Perfect. I'll leave. Don't waste my time. I have other things to do. The slow maybe is the worst too. Like, oh, I really like you. I really like your business. Just not sure if we're going to be. I don't know. That's really not helpful. The partner, I've had this happen to me so many times. The partner is just unprofessional. Just won't even call. Like, I'm a serious entrepreneur. I've been through this rodeo. I've been like, give me the courtesy at least to show up to a meeting on time, or give me a call, or make a phone call, or anything. I like the written yes. I love the written yes. I love the written yes in an email. I'll send the written yes to everybody. Hey, Joey's in. Look right here, Joey's in. Everybody loves that, and it's the word spreads really quickly because they know the momentum starts to pick up from then on in. And I don't know what this empty road has to do with anything, but so what if you have a yes, now what? You start telling people. You start getting, hey, this deal is going to happen. Something's going to happen. I literally tell everybody. You may need a lead. In the end of the day, this is me being lazy putting this slide up, by the way. So you may need to club a deal, which is you get a whole bunch of people who want to participate in the deal without a lead. But you may need a lead to write a term sheet for you, and that's just a way for them to architect the deal. If you argue over valuation, it's probably a bad idea, because eventually the VCs win. I don't like to put it like that, but it's the truth. Because once you take money from outside investors, you're kind of stuck, you're joined at the hip with them. And that means if they don't invest in your company going forward, you're probably going to get deep sixed. So it's better to understand that get into a deal that you know full well that how much equity you're going to give up eventually anyway. You might need to, if you execute flawlessly and you put the VCs against the wall, you may end up with more ownership, but it's really hard to execute flawlessly in a startup. They want 20%. That's at the beginning, and usually at subsequent rounds, that's a nice magic number. Seed people and friends and family don't care. Come up and they're like, I've never had a question from somebody who's a friend and family who say, well, what's the valuation? Nobody cares. And they write you a check. They don't care. And giving up less than 20% of the company is sort of unreasonable. It's hard to make the economics work on their side if you look at it from their perspective. And if you give up more than 50%, don't do it unless somebody's giving you a ton of money. It's a moral story. And your ownership looks something like this. over time is that you end up with this nice little meet at the end. Mark Zuckerberg ended up with a quarter of his company at the end. You know, a lot of really great founders end up with a good chunk of it. Steve Jobs ended up with like single-digit percentages of Apple, but a single-digit percentage over a, you know, multi-hundred billion-dollar company is still many billions of dollars. So at the end of the day, it does matter, but just know that you're gonna have to give up some equity. This is just some other references. I love a lot of information out there for crafting your process. I look at things like The Funded, I look at Crunchbase all the time. There's a good presentation on a thing called Resonance that's, I don't know if you've heard of Nancy Duarte, who does presentations, who does stuff on Slideology and Resonance. Resonance is about like spark lines, like talking about having a story that has a beginning, an end, a climax, and in between, and how you sort of craft it. She also, Slideology is a great thing for color and using type and just how to craft the overall layout of it. Again, Keynote Pro will help a lot of any of you that don't really want to go through the motions on it, just want a good layout idea. There's a report on all the economics in venture capital. Wilson Sonsini does one. Guy Kawasaki has a great set of videos on how to make a pitch. He has a 10-20-30 rule. Did you hear this? It's like 10 slides, 20 minutes, 30 point. I don't necessarily agree with that. If I have a presentation that I want to get through and I want to make it's 30 minutes, I'll make 60 slides. And I'll just do them half a minute each, or a quarter of a minute each, or something really, really fast. I usually like more slides to keep things going. You have any questions? Email me. That's Marcus. All classes. That's Raising Venture Capital. Any questions? Shoot, Sean.
So this is really thoughtful remarks, Steve, and a lot of fun to listen to. But if you're running a company too, how do you split up your time between the two, thinking about the fundraising piece versus executing? Because you still have to deliver on.
Well, so it's like saying, how do you think about sales when you have all the operations stuff to go on? I think financing a business is just another function in the business. This one, you know, some entrepreneurs will only raise capital a few times in their life. And if you haven't been through this a whole bunch of times, it does tend to consume you. It's very time consuming. To have 100 no's in a conversation, or just even to have had that many conversations is really hard. That's why having a co-founder is always helpful, because I dump a lot on my co-founder to do some things. But it's tough. But you have to balance everything. You have to balance work and life, you know, just.
Do you have a secret metric, or is it just get a co-founder?
Secret metric.
Time up front.
Oh, how much time do you devote to raising capital?
Yeah, like when you think about raising the capital versus executing on the
plan. I say it takes 6 months to raise capital of somebody probably full-time doing it. So yeah, it takes a good chunk of time, but usually after you raise capital, it should last you 12 to 18 months. So it's about a third of your time, yeah. It's time consuming when you're in the process. Afterward, it's not. Like right now, I have no fundraising work to do, which is nice. Yeah, good question.
For your early round, Series A, let's say, like, would you take money from, like, would you recommend a top-tier VC money with more stringent terms versus second-tier money?
The irony is that the top-tier firms don't give you stringent terms. Isn't that interesting? Is that a B-team firm will give you a much tougher term sheet than a top-tier will. I found super simple stuff with a top-tier firm. Absolutely good for get top-tier money. Usually the smartest people in the room, they ask the best questions. They are usually great to have in a boardroom. They're people that'll challenge you and push you. They have no time for bolt. Like, they will not let you be lazy in any aspect of the business. So be prepared to be like literally somebody with a hot poker behind you the whole time, but it's gonna be smart money. Absolutely, if you can get it, you take top tier money, without a doubt. There was a question over here too. Go ahead.
I have a question about traction, because sometimes to build traction, you need to raise money.
Yep.
But when you go to raise money, they ask you to have some traction.
Yeah, you need money to make money, right? Yeah, no, it's the complete, it's almost hypocritical. It's like one of those things is like, well, if I had traction, we wouldn't be having this conversation, right? Like, I think that there's a perspective on marketing these days that's also, you don't need as much money as you used to market. So a lot of things catch fire virally, and they're able to be marketed for not much money. So I think the hope is that you at least get some market indication early. And if you do that right, if you're a great social marketer, if you're a great marketer in general, marketing right now is so transformed that if you can use it, you have a huge advantage. But it is sort of, it depends on the business too. Like if it's an enterprise software company, somebody's not gonna walk in and go, yeah, how much traction you have? Well, I need $20 million to make the product. Like I haven't even started to make it yet. It really depends on the business. If you're talking about consumer business, yeah, you're kind of hosed because they would say, try to do that. Depends on where you're getting the money from. If you raise a seed capital, usually you don't have to have as many proof points in there. If you raise Series A capital, it usually means like you have some traction, you have somebody that's indicated that it's worthwhile. So you just have to use that seed money wisely and try to get some traction. Yeah. Good.
How do VCs, or maybe from your own experience as an entrepreneur, view investing some of your own personal wealth in a startup or in a new company? Is that, from your experience, is that good? Is that bad? Do VCs see it as something good, something they don't care about?
As a VC, I didn't care whether or not you put money into it. In fact, I would say that's a bigger risk for a venture-funded company to have the founder financially welded to the business to make sure that they need to actually, like, they can't survive. They've invested too much money. Usually, VCs want you to have a little bit more financial comfort so that you can focus on the business. So I'm not as concerned about it. When I was PE-backed, when I was raising that money to do a take private, they insisted that I put money into it. It was mandatory to put money into it because it was a financial windfall if the deal happened for us as the operators. And so this got us to be committed to the deal. Good question, though. Please.
I found that raising the A round is relatively easy because you're just selling a story.
Yep.
Usually you have a concept, a bench, screen, some basic. The B round that's really hard.
Yep.
Then you've proven that it works or not and come across all the inevitable challenges. How do you think about B round differently? How much time between, do you want to give yourself breathing room, and how do you feel about tranching?
So B round is definitely where you no longer can sell sizzle, you got to sell the steak. And it is hard. And now, even these days, Series A is becoming harder because people get a lot of seed money together and they really don't have much else, as you were saying before, about traction. They don't have much on, meat on the bone. So it's hard. That's why it's nice to get a firm involved in the business early. And that way, they'll let you put some points on the board in some other ways. Like if you recruit a great team, if you have, let's say, supplier traction, maybe not as much customer traction, if you got some movement on the product, like you guys are humming as a team in so many other regards, that they'll get behind it, and they're more willing to put money on the table to let you sort of keep going. Tranching, it's sort of like saying like it's a financial tool to try to get somebody on board. Like if you hit this milestone, I will add more money to it. It's a nice way to get something pre-baked. Generally, I don't like tranching because it usually means that they're pricing something in. Like, if I suddenly hit all my customer numbers or I hit some number out of the park, I'm hosed because they can put more money in at a cheaper price. Technically, the company's worth more now. Like, it is. There's some pricing in it too. Plus, I might want to get other capital now involved in it, and I might not want those people to just that be my only basic capital. So, would you like to have more financial leverage than tranching provides? One back there.
So, how many no's would take you to pivot the idea? Like you're actually raising money, you can get in 100 no's. Like, how many no's is enough to actually say, probably not a good idea?
Actually, that's a really good question. I feel like I've made 100 micro pivots in those no's. Actually, I am pivoting the business. I am pivoting the plan. Usually I have a vision for what I want at the destination, and that usually doesn't get interrupted. It's just how you go about executing on that plan or how you go, like for instance, when I started All Classes, I pitched it as a marketplace. And so I had talked to a whole bunch of people about marketplace businesses and I became an expert on marketplaces and realized it takes a lot of capital to start a marketplace from the get-go and actually sort of pivoted away from that idea. I like the idea of a marketplace and I want to eventually become a marketplace. But I realized it was better to pitch it as a search engine because it was things that we could materially affect right now. And there were strategies you had to employ for marketplace that just weren't tenable to do in the beginning, especially with a small amount of capital. So I think they happen all the time. In fact, that's exactly what this deck, if I showed you my classes deck from when I started raising money from when I actually did raise money, they do look like two very different businesses. But that's the point. You're in a room with a bunch of really smart people that ask you really tough questions, and they have seen that movie play out. Like, I sat in front of marketplace people who have seen, like, Uber play out, and they could tell me what plays work there, and I realized whether or not I wanted to actually continue with the marketplace. Good question. Go ahead.
How important is friends and family money before you go to, you know, proper angels or VCs for seed money?
It depends on if you, you know, if you need the money.
I mean, is it an important signal, or is it not?
No, it's no signal at all. Typically, what happens in a venture deal is you go to a venture capitalist first, they give you a term sheet for a chunk of the money, and then they go, say, fill it in with angels. And that's when you call mom and dad or everybody else to go put money into it. If you didn't want to raise venture capital and you just wanted to put together a couple hundred grand from some friends and family to get the idea off the ground, or just to pay, you know, to afford to sort of get going, you probably couldn't get traction from that unless you had some really wealthy friends or family.
You only need a couple hundred thousand to build the thing
to get it out there, yeah. No, that's right. That's what people usually do, is they usually get some money together to sort of get a proof of concept or get some, like, thing held together, you know, duct tape and shoestring, and they're like, hey, you know, it'll do it, kind of. But, you know, it's not a signal for VCs. VCs are signals for VCs.
If you were fundraising, let's say you're working full-time or part-time, do you recommend that, or would you rather focus on full-time for 6 months or whatever?
I took the simulation. I was a WPI undergrad, and like it was an HBS, like you know, it was DVD at the time, or a CD-ROM they gave you. And like, it was like this game you play. And the first question was, can you do it full time or part time? And the answer is that you need to do it full time. That the HBS, although they impart that on you, it really is the case is that it consumes you. I mean, I work 24/7, not 24/7 straight, but I'm always working. I always have something to do. Whether it's, you know, fundraising or sales or whatever, I have some aspect of my business that I need to focus on all the time. It's just too much to do. You can't physically do it part time.
What is your advice on the number of VCs or angels? Do you look for a smaller number or a bigger number?
For what? How
many funds?
Do I reach out to in the fundraising process?
Yeah.
I make a list of 200. And literally, I know them all. I've met most of those funds. And I'll go to the people that I know first, or I'll go to the people that I think know the business really well first, and work my way up, you know, through the list. And I just keep track of it. But I don't go all 200 at once. I sort of work my way through the list. So maybe 5 to 10 at once. You know, there's some rule of thumb that if you get past the first meeting on more than 5 or 6, you're probably going to be swamped, because they ask a lot of diligence questions. They're going to want to talk to, you know. If you have a business with customers or suppliers, you don't want to inundate all those people with stuff, and you know, just try to work a handful unless you're really good at managing that big a process.
But your final number of VCs or investors, do you like it small or big?
I typically like it small. I'd much prefer to have 2 checks than 20. It's a lot of people to coordinate, but sometimes it works out. I raised $1.5 million and there was a good chunk of investors in it, say 12 people in that deal. More than I've ever had in one round. But it worked out.
Excellent, great presentation. I'd like to ask a question about VCs and their perception. Do they prefer to see a team of people or founders, or they would fund you when you're just a single founder?
I've been funded both ways. I would say that it's always better to have co-founders. And Ed Roberts, who still teaches here, has some data on that the number of co-founders is directly correlated with how successful you'll be. So it is better to have more. I think it's up to 7 or something, he says, is helpful. You know, you get a lot of free labor, right? I mean, co-founders are going to demand less on a salary basis. You're going to get more out of them. So functionally, you'll be more diverse, and you'll be able to get a lot more done. It's a lot harder if you're a solo founder. If you're an amazing solo founder, it can be done. If you quickly surround yourself with really smart people, like, you still have to hire those people. So if you come in with saying, like, hey, I'm one-man band, but I got these 5 other people that I've already got on my team or I'm ready to tap, you'll be fine. Yeah, you have to pay them. Yeah.
have you been in a situation or seen a startup in a situation where the VCs come in and after about 6 or 8 months decide you're the wrong man?
More often than not. It's like saying, you know, I mean, your parents were probably really good at We'll leave your parents out of it. You know, companies grow up, right? At different phases. Like, I'm not somebody who comes, I know a certain phase of the business really well. And somebody might come in and say, you know what, I want to bring in somebody who knows it better than you. And that's reasonable. And eventually you want to replace yourself anyway. You want to keep surrounding yourself with really smart people. Being a great manager is not being a great doer. It's being a great, you can hire the best people around you and pushing the organization, challenging them, and leading. And I think there's a lot of stuff, there are just certain things you get with a founding team, and most founding teams don't scale. That's the way it is. Like, unless you come in with a great operator, you don't want to have somebody who's just managing public companies running a startup just as much as you don't want to have somebody running a startup managing a public company. Completely different things. So sadly, it's just some people know that they're really good at certain phases of the business, and some people don't and have to be thrown out. But invariably, that's it more often than not, sadly.
Benchmarks, what's the right size of a board during your own stage?
Boards are tough to manage in the beginning. I would say, you know, Howard Anderson here prefers the, I think he prefers the odd number, the even number, so that everybody has to come to consensus. There's no, like, sort of tie break. I like the even number. I like to keep it small, so a couple board members would be fine, me and somebody else, potentially a third person. But, you know, it becomes a lot of, like, there's not much to talk about in a board meeting at a seed stage company. What the hell are you going to talk about? I mean, like, you don't have any operating metrics yet. I mean, you just, what, are you going to talk about spending money or, like, whether or not you hit some goals? Like, I can write you an email. I don't need to be in a board meeting for that, right?
I'm thinking more around an A round.
Yeah, I've seen boards, you know, 4 or 5 person boards, probably the right number. You know, beyond that, it starts to be good, a little bit of a, you know, shit show. Go ahead.
Is to raise money to get the first check or first commitment from a West Coast VC if you're located in this
country? I think quite easy, because if you go to the West Coast, everybody's like, wow, so competitive out here. You talk to VCs, is like, you know, the worst things happen to them, because they're like, everybody, there's too much money, chasing too few deals, and all of them are just starting to look off the reservation for other deals. And so they're like, oh, you know, maybe there's something in New York, or maybe there's something in Boston, or maybe there's something in Duluth, I don't know, you know, wherever. They're just sort of going off the reservation. Those who are the top tier are very snooty about it. It's very hard to get somebody. They're allergic to airplanes for some reason. It's like, oh, airplane? Who goes to the airport? I'm not going to the airport. So it depends. New York is the new hotspot. Everybody likes it. So it's hard. I'm not going to say it's easy. It's hard. We have more time for questions.
Yeah, we can go 3:05. We can go through. I mean, next session is circle 3.
Can you say anything about the pros and cons of like a Kickstarter campaign in terms of what that does for the rest of the business, the rest of your fundraising?
Depends on what you can prove with the money. Like, if you gave me $50,000, I'm not sure what I could prove. I'm just not somebody who tries to put a company together on such tight budget. But if you can prove something for $50,000, like you want to build your product and you can get somebody, you can get sort of a group of people to want to give you money, it's awesome. I the first thing I do when I start a company is I typically make the product. How I got into Matchbox is I made the product for MIT. And I made it for me, kind of. I mean, at the end of the day, while I was doing some work for admissions, I made the product. And I got them to pay me to make the product. It was great. And so I got a proof of concept. I mean, it didn't require that much capital. And then everybody started calling and saying, hey, how do I get the product? And so for me, that would have been enough, you know, to get it going on my own. But not all products are done that way. I'd say it's dependent on the product, depends on the market, depends on for your financial need for it. But there are a lot of products now that just don't take that much money to build. So if you can get it done for less, I would definitely get it done for less. It's free money. Not free money, but it's light commitment money, right? Right, John.
You talked about a pretty complicated process if you've got to sort of talk to 100 different investors.
Yep.
Do you have a specific set of software tools you use to manage that? Do you distribute it? Is it all on you?
Excel.
Really? Yeah, still Excel. It's still Excel.
I got one table. In fact, I even have it in this deck. I have one table, and I put the list of firms. I put who I know and how I know if I need a connection to them or who it is. I'll do some homework on the fund and say, do I know a partner there that knows the area? And I'll put the partner's name on it. on it, and I will say which stage it gets. I'll start them all from zero. A negative one is somebody who's like a dead deal, like if they pass or, and I categorize it. Is it a hard pass? Is it a soft pass? A soft pass is like somebody goes to, I don't really like it. Okay, that's fine, that's a soft pass. Somebody goes to a partner meeting and you get a pass, that's a hard pass. Don't go back there. And then they'll work their way up. I'll go from zero to one to two, three, and four. And usually by like stage four, they're a term sheet. It's all like a Salesforce, you know, process. Yeah. Just a very simple way to keep track of it. It's too many balls in the air, but it's the same thing for all of them. So that's why it's easy to use Excel
for. Do you use Salesforce or anything?
Nah. In fact, I wouldn't advise you. 100 VCs is a long list of people, but I got a lot of no's. So I had to work my way around. It took me a while.
Process. So, do you identify other opportunities in the education space?
Oh, tons. You have to map the whole. I mean, when I walk in, everybody expects me to be an education expert. Right. I mean, that's just the way it is. Everybody, you all graduated from MIT. Everybody expects you to know be quant jocks, right? You walk out of here, and you're like, you guys know math, right? You guys went to MIT. It's the same thing with me, right? I mean, you come out of there, they're like, you know education, right? Yeah, I know education. Sure, I know it. But yeah, you have to map the whole thing, right? You got to know where you fit in it. So yeah, there's lots of opportunities in education. EdTech's hot. It's a great place to be. And you want to be in markets where actually a lot of the money's flowing. It sounds counterintuitive, but if you get the message, you're like, wow, a lot of these EdTech companies are getting funded, probably a good time to be an EdTech entrepreneur because people speak the language, they're more comfortable, capital flows more freely. If you walk in and be like, I want to start, a social networking company, not good. Deal dead, right? Because nobody's investing in that category. It's sort of like they move in swarms around markets.
Is it more B2B or B2C where you see opportunity?
Everywhere. I mean, it's like healthcare, right? I mean, right now the focus is on education, very broad. A lot of B2B companies, a lot of B2C opportunities.
I find the most important thing to do is to find together what you've got another competitive. Right, you got to have all the patents, in academics. You know, the key thought is everything in your head and produce your paper, or you'll be blown away.
That's another good thing to note. Is that the VC piece I talked about kind of works. I found my fundraising process worked the same for PE or VC. It was a very similar sort of process, like pitching to them. They look for very different things though. You know, I need to talk more about the cash and the private equity business and about how they're going to get the return on the capital right from the get-go, how I'm going to work through the balance sheet and the financials and how I'm going to make this a stronger company and how we're going to grow it. In a biotech company, you have to talk about patents. You have to talk about a lot of different things. You're doing a hardware company, you got to talk about different angles. I mean, very similar overtones, very similar sort of structure, but different hot buttons. I think we got to end it here. Well, one more question?
Yeah, go for a few more. Okay.
All right.
So, last question. If you, for example, would it be better if you have a prototype to just build a video of the software and just email it to all the people that you're interested in, and if they're interested, then they will get back to you?
I never read that, though, man. I'll tell you, if I'm not interested in the company by the fourth line of the email, I'm not watching videos. I spoke to 1,000, when I was a VC, 1,000 companies a year. 1,000 companies a year. That was my prospect sheet. I don't have time to waste on a lot of things. I got stuff that I had to DQ really quickly. That's why send me the deck usually means like, don't waste my time. And it's better just to email people that know the space. Just be like, hey, I got something you might be interested in because you've invested in these four other companies that are around it, or you might be knowledgeable about it. And so it's better just to whet their appetite. I never send attachments, presentations, demos, anything to somebody that I haven't met or met with face-to-face or talked to face or on the phone. So just a nice, like, whet their appetite email, then you can show them things. Okay? Any other questions? All right. Thanks, everybody.